Good afternoon to all of you all. And I think we come to a very sedentary topic of antibiotics after all the running around in the ICU with ventilators and asthma. I think this is a very critical era of antibiotic, and WHO has actually dedicated 1 year towards antibiotic resistance. Just as community-acquired infections are being, we're seeing a lot of MDR drugs in the community because of irrational use of antibiotics in the community. Similarly, in the ICU, we see a lot of infections which are just becoming difficult to treat, especially nowadays we are coming across pan-resistant bacteria. I'm not going to touch on fungal infections because this will be taking the lecture too long. So I'm going to talk on really on just antibiotic use in the PICU. Now, antibiotic usage is actually an art, and it took a long time to understand the use of antibiotics. Sometimes we land up using such irrational combinations of antibiotics that it becomes a problem when we are treating patients. There was a time when I used to see a lot of NICU patients, and I had a tough time convincing the neonatologist about the antibiotics. I mean, when I would go to the NICU, I would say, you take your first line as Ampigenta. And by the time I would get a call on day 14, the child would have already been on colistin, and then they would be at their wits' end what to do. So sometimes most of the NICUs that I see, their first line actually goes on as ceftriaxone amphotericin. By day 3, the child is on to piperacillin vancomycin. By day 7, the child is on meropenem ciprofloxacin. By day 10, the child is on colistin. And these are all culture negative patients. So at the end, at day 10, by that time the child has gone on to liposomal amphoby. And by day 14, when I see the patient, he's thrombocytopenic, he's septic, and you have a Klebsiella growing or you have a Pseudomonas growing, that's not really sensitive to anything. So before we jump on, we tend to press the panic button too fast in the ICU. And before we jump on to changing antibiotics like this, it has to be a team effort. You need to get your microbiologist onto the team. You need to get your ID specialist onto the team to decide on the choice of antibiotics. Abroad where I trained, even to start ceftriaxone in the ICU, they had to consult the pharmacist, the ID specialist and the microbiologist before even selecting one drug as an antibiotic in the ICU. Combination therapy was almost a no-no. I mean, we would not even think of combination. Just to start ceftriaxone would be such a team effort that to go on to combination was something which was not thought of. Now, before we go on to antibiotics, I want to take you down memory lane. Fleming discovered penicillin, and that was the era where the antibiotics actually started, and he got the Nobel Prize for it. He made a statement which was very relevant in 1940s. This was during his Nobel Prize lecture. He made this statement actually. It is not difficult to make microbes resistant to penicillin in the laboratory by exposing them to concentrations not sufficient to kill them. And the same thing has occasionally happened in the body. There is the danger that the ignorant man may easily underdose himself and by exposing his microbes to non-lethal quantities of the drug, make them more resistant. This is in 1945, the statement came out. And we already know that we are sometimes using antibiotics not at the right dosing. How many of us would actually know that amoxicillin in a community-acquired pneumonia would be required at 90 mg per kg per day for streptococcus pneumonia? Very few of us. We still continue to give 30 to 50 mg per kg per day. And then we get resistance. We don't see actually still penicillin-resistant streptococcus pneumonia in India, but it's a phenomenon already in the US, and we would definitely be going on to vancomycin very soon if we are going to see this kind of resistance. 1920s, penicillin first came out, and we had a lot of drugs, antibiotics that came out later. 1930s, sulfonamides, 1940s, and the 1950s were the golden era for antibiotics. We had so many antibiotics that came out at that time. Aminoglycosides, your synthetic penicillins, chloramphenicol, tetracyclines, macrolides, vancomycin, rifampicin, everything came out in this era. 1960s, the quinolones came out. 1970s, trimethoprim and the cephalosporins came out. From 1970s to 1990s, we had a lot of gap. We really had no new antibiotic that came out. What came out was 1990, linezolid is what came out. And in 2000s, daptomycin came out. So you can see practically after 1960s, we've not really had newer molecules being generated. What we are now juggling with antibiotics is basically juggling with the old molecules. We are back to colistin, polymyxin, tigecycline. We are going back to tetracyclines. so many times I get a reference from some NICU in the city saying we have this span-resistant Klebsiella, and I have to tell them, okay, look, use tetracycline. Tetracycline in a neonate, a tetracycline in a neonate, it actually becomes so difficult for me to tell them that use this drug, because you don't know how much harm you're causing to this patient by using it. And the most important thing is the emergence of resistance. 1920s, the drugs came out. 1947, staph is already resistant to penicillin. 1955, erythromycin. 1961, first time MRSA has been documented. 1982, MRSA becomes resistant to cephalosporin. So in just a matter of 4-5 years, then you have penicillin-resistant enterococcus, a vancomycin-resistant enterococcus. 1990s was the era of MDR, and that is the time we really didn't have any drugs coming out. Pseudomonas, MDR TB, BRSA, vancomycin resistant staph aureus, MRSA resistant to quinolones. And 2000s, all these MRSA, all these MDR drugs have spilled over into the community. So we actually have community acquired MRSA. We have linezolid resistant enterococcus now. We have linezolid resistant staph aureus. So we are into an era where we are jumping onto, almost we could say we are reaching an era of pan resistant organisms, and we ourselves are to be blamed because we are using antibiotics left, right and center. There was a question on use of antibiotics in asthma. I mean, we press the panic button so frequently that any child who comes with fever, wheezing, standard prescription is amoxiclav, nebulization and probably oseltamivir. That's a standard prescription that is given for any patient with an LRTI. So we just have 7 known groups of antibiotic drugs. And we all know that resistance is there for most of the groups. Most of the antibiotics have become resistant in 1 to 4 years after their introduction. So this is the kind of resistance pattern that you're seeing. Only resistance that took longer time to develop was basically vancomycin. But on an average, otherwise, most of the antibiotics within first 5 years of introduction. So this is the slide. Again, it's a different, it's a timeline from the time that the antibiotics were used to the time that the antibiotics became resistant. So you can see sulfonamides came here, resistance immediately. Penicillin came here, resistance immediately. Tetracycline, chloramphenicol. So in a span of 4 to 5 years, you're getting resistance to most of the drugs. Linezolid in 2000s, 2005, linezolid is resistant. So these are the kind of organisms that we are seeing. I remember seeing one child in Nanavati ICU. This child had a parotid abscess, which grew a VRSA, community-acquired VRSA, 5-month-old. And we had to put this child on basically linezolid clindamycin combination. This child went on to develop a liver abscess, which caused a portal vein obstruction, developed a portal cavernoma. So I have a child who's had an infection and now subsequently landed up with extrahepatic portal hypertension as a portal cavernoma. So it's just community-acquired infections that are now playing a havoc. These antibiotic-resistant bugs in the ICU, very few, but very difficult to eradicate. We've got staph aureus, MRSA, VRSA. We've got enterococcus, that is vancomycin resistance now. Clostridium difficile in a child, very, very difficult. I came across an article recently in NEJM, which was published last year, 2013, especially about the adult ICUs, where they have found Clostridium difficile extremely difficult to eradicate in patients who've been on multiple antibiotics. And the article talked about therapy with donor feces. It was such a revolting thought to give donor feces through the RT. I mean, to take somebody else's stool and push it down through the RT as a therapy was something now that people are trying out for Clostridium difficile. So you have these gram-negative bacteria, that is your Klebsiella, Acinetobacter, Pseudomonas, Enterobacter, and the Enterobacteria. Now these are the common problems in all the ICUs. Once your ICU has Acinetobacter, it's extremely difficult to eradicate. There are lots of things that need to be done. It's not only antibiotics. There's a lot of hand hygiene, a lot of isolation processes that have to be taken care of. Now, when I'm talking about isolation practices, most of the hospitals would isolate a case of MRSA. But the moment I tell them, look, you have a pan-resistant or you have a imipenem, carbapenem-resistant Klebsiella, you need to isolate this patient, they'll not isolate the patient. You will have him in the ward or in the ICU with the rest of the patients. So till we don't have isolation practices in place, how are we going to eradicate these bugs? It's not possible. So very gloomy picture. Multi-drug resistant pathogens are becoming more common. We don't have any more antibiotics coming out in the market. we just have to juggle with the antibiotics that we have. So rational use of antibiotics is absolutely essential. Now, this was a major problem in the US. In India, we could say that we have no really original articles coming out on antibiotic resistance in various ICUs. Every hospital would be doing their audit, but there's no published data that is really available to tell us how much is the resistance in the community or in the hospitals. But US has been very proactive regarding this. In 2004, IDSA, the International Disease Infectious Disease Society of America, they came out with an article in 2004. They sent a white paper to the Capitol Hill stressing the rapidly growing public health crisis and the emergence of bacteria that were resistant to many. So they actually sent a paper to the parliament. In California in 2006, a law was passed, and this law became a kind of a Senate Bill 739, which people all over the world are trying to follow this particular act. And what did that law say? That by the year 2008, all general acute care hospitals will have to evaluate the antibiotic use. They will have to create an oversight committee to monitor responsibilities for this issue. So it was a law. And the California Department of Public Health responsible for implementing a program for the statewide surveillance and prevention of hospital-acquired infections in acute care. So this became a law. Now all the hospitals had to have their antibiotic stewardship program in place. And that's how antibiotic stewardship came into the picture. Now what is this antibiotic stewardship? Very complex, but in short, if I try to tell you, it's a program to monitor use of antibiotics. It's a coordinated effort between the pharmacist, microbiologist, the infectious disease specialist, and the medical team. And what's the rationale behind this antibiotic stewardship? You minimize the use of antibiotics. Why? Because you want to prevent toxicity, you want to prevent resistance, you want to prevent emergence of MDR strains, and you want to take care of Clostridium difficile. Only antibiotic stewardship is not going to take care of it. You also need to combine it with infection control, isolation practices, disinfection. And ultimate goal is to reduce the healthcare costs without adversely impacting care. Most of the patients who are admitted in the ICU, they recover from their primary cause very early. They have an extended stay in the ICU just to take care of hospital-acquired infection. So most of the times, even in not in only in your patients, even in your relatives, you may have come across, he got admitted to the ICU for some other problem, and there has been a prolonged ICU stay just for infection. There have been guidelines that have been published to develop an institutional antibiotic program. So antibiotic stewardship committee has to be formed. There has to be a computer surveillance. There has to be a software developed to decide on an antibiogram. What's the status of resistance in your hospital? You need to have a very proactive microbiology lab. Your lab should give you a lot of support regarding the resistance. And then you need to have an audit of your program as to what's happening, how can you change, how do you change your antibiotic surveillance. So you identify certain risk factors. The patient age, is he an older patient who's been having some problems? Is it a neonate? Any previous hospitalizations, previous antibiotics? Where do they live, any comorbid conditions? Whether they have HIV or any organ transplant. What is the risk of developing an MDR organism, especially if the ICU stay emerges longer? The hospital antibiogram. What were the previous months? When I go to the ICU, I just have to ask them, which is the bug prevalent right now in the ICU? I have to assume that this child who's suffering from the current infection is also having the same. Like I recently saw a child in the NICU as a reference for neonatal cholestasis. I had two patients with severe combined immunodeficiency admitted under me, and they had an ICU stay and they had come back and they were still running high grade fever. So I had to go back to the ICU and ask them, what's the bug in your ICU? And they said, there's candida. And when I actually started liposomal amphoby without waiting for the fungal culture reports. And when the culture reports came, one was harboring Saccharomyces and the other was harboring candida tropicalis. So there were these bugs in the ICU, and when I went to the I had to go to each department because we don't really have a committee there. So I went to the microbiology and said, what's happening? Are you taking the samples? And they told me there's candida in the air. So I said, if you have your air sample that is having candida, what are you doing about it in the ICU? And they said, we can't do anything. Probably at the most, we will be able to paint the walls and that's get out of it. most of the hospitals with the ICU don't have HEPA filters. They don't have distance between the beds that is required. They don't really have continuous changing of filters in the AC. So there are these problems which are there, which we need to take care of. Regarding antibiotics in the ICU, I remember once I had a resident who had this habit of being in the casualty all the time, ICU resident, and whenever there was a patient who used to come to the casualty, he would say, start the oxygen, put in an IV line, put in a urinary catheter and start an antibiotic and then shift to the ICU. Okay, so they had this standard protocol of doing all this. So I think most of the ICUs also have this habit, okay, patient has gone into the ICU, let's put them on an antibiotic. Let's not do it that way. Let's not start antibiotics too early, but let's not also be too late. Let us be appropriate. You need to give as narrow spectrum antibiotic as possible. You don't need to start meropenem, vancomycin right away in the ICU to cover as many organisms as possible. But what you could do is use a narrow spectrum. You need to decide on your pharmacokinetic, pharmacodynamic data. A lot of times I just look at the MIC and I tell them, okay, this particular antibiotic, instead of giving it over 4 hours, you give it as a continuous infusion over 24 hours. It's going to work. It's not going to be resistant. So you work it out like that. So you don't need to jump onto colistin right away. So you need to know your PK/PD data. If you've started on a higher one, on a broad spectrum, you need to come down to a narrow spectrum. You need to de-escalate. If you started on a narrow spectrum, but you find that you've got a pan-resistant bug or something like which is ESBL, you need to probably escalate your antibiotic. And you need to discontinue it when you're not using it. This is the most important slide of the entire talk. Whenever you use an antibiotic, you need to know where it's going to work. You are going to use antibiotics just because, okay, piperacillin tazobactam, or because Klebsiella is there, so I'll use that, or I think we are facing a lot of gram-negative bacteria, so let's just use meropenem. You need to know where these antibiotics work. Now, most of your beta-lactam antibiotics are going to work on the cell wall, so your penicillin, cephalosporins, vancomycin, your carbapenems, they're going to work here. Whereas if you take the ribosomes, your aminoglycosides, macrolides, tetracycline, clinda, chloramphenicol are going to work on your ribosomes. The antibiotics that are going to work on your DNA are your quinolones, metronidazole, cotrimoxazole, rifampicin. And only on the cell membrane are your polymyxins, your colistin, and your linezolid. So what is going to help you here is decide what combinations to use, when to use which combination. So many times I have seen a combination being prescribed of amoxiclav and probably cloxacillin in the child. You have amoxiclav, which is a penicillin, synthetic penicillin. You have cloxacillin, which is also a synthetic penicillin. By using these two together, you're not achieving much. Okay, so you say, okay, I have a community-acquired pneumonia. I'm going to put the child on amoxiclav for streptococcus pneumonia. I'm going to put cloxacillin to cover the staph aureus. But you use two antibiotics that were working at the same level, from the same group of antibiotics. It's not going to work. So you need to rationalize your combination. Ideally, try to use an antibiotic that's going to work for both and then rationalize it. So you can't have a standard antibiotic protocol for any ICU which says, okay, first line is this, second line is this, third line is this. Or in the NICU which says, probably you could decide your first line and your second line, but beyond that you wouldn't be able to decide which is going to be your third line or fourth line. Similarly, for every community-acquired infections, you could have your first line depending on the local epidemiology, what's prevalent in the community, decide your first line. But beyond that, to decide a second line, you wouldn't be able to decide that. So you can't have a guideline which says, okay, this is going to be my second line. You need to decide on the epidemiology, the organism that you're growing, and then take a call on the second line. So these are the same things, the antibiotics, how they work. As I told you, on the cell wall, penicillin, cephalosporins, carbapenems, and your glycopeptides. The other thing is you need to know your pharmacokinetic dynamics, whether they are time-dependent or concentration-dependent. That will help you to decide on the dosing of antibiotics, whether you need to give it 4-hourly, 6-hourly, continuous infusion, or once a day. So it's important to know which antibiotic is going to work how. So we know that sometimes we need to give meropenem as a continuous infusion. There have been reports of people using vancomycin as continuous infusion because they have time-dependent pharmacodynamics. That means you need to maintain a steady level of that particular antibiotic for all the time. Whereas when you have concentration dependent, you could get away with just once a dose because you need to have a high dose at a particular time, and then the post-antibiotic effect is going to take place. Now I'm going to talk on the resistance, how these resistance occurs. Why do we need to go on to narrow spectrum antibiotics? Is that today I used a broad spectrum antibiotic. Whatever is the flora of that particular patient is going to become resistant to that particular bug or to that antibiotic. With the help of plasmids or other genetic material, that particular resistant mutation is going to skip into the pathogenic bug. So that's how your community acquired infections are moving. So most of the times your ESBL are actually being transferred by your plasmids. Now, aminoglycosides, basically you have enzyme inactivation. Your beta-lactams is basically going to be beta-lactamases or the carbapenemase. Quinolones is because of mutations in the DNA gyri. And tetracyclines is because they are being thrown out of the cell. Vancomycin is because of altered binding. So you have a different mechanism for each antibiotic, how these antibiotics are getting resistance. What is important is the plasmid-mediated resistance. There are these, which I told you, you get a particular bug which is resistant. The extracellular chromosome is going to jump from one bug to the other. That's why you need a bed distance of 3 feet. If you don't have that, it's going to jump onto the other bug and you're going to land up with a resistant bug in that particular patient. So that's the reason, use as narrow spectrum antibiotics as possible. The other thing is whenever you're using an antibiotic, you need to ask your lab what technique of resistance they're telling you. Are they telling you by disc diffusion method or are they telling you by MICs? Ideally, you should have MICs to actually tell you whether you could use a higher level of a higher dose of the antibiotic. Disc diffusion will, this is a disc diffusion, which over here on this plate that you're seeing. You put a drug and you see the zone of inhibition that develops. That's just an arbitrary, it's an in vitro method. In vivo, it doesn't tell you whether it works. Usually, most of the labs will do disc diffusion. And most of the labs, disc diffusion will correlate with the MICs. But suppose you have an antibiotic that's pan resistant and you want to know whether you could use meropenem or colistin, it's better to have an MIC. You could actually give a higher dose if your MIC is in the intermediate level. So ask your labs if they could provide you with MICs in most of the patients. Now, risk of developing antibiotic resistance, use a broad spectrum antibiotics. I've already told you that. The other thing is the biofilm. Most of these antibiotics, especially in cystic fibrosis patients or patients with dialysis catheter or patients with central venous lines, they're going to form a biofilm. Your candida, your staph aureus, your pseudomonas, and these become very difficult to eradicate. So another problem is the biofilms. And then the bugs change. The staph aureus now started producing toxins, you know, of PVL staph. So even your cloxacillin or vancomycin is not going to work if the staph is producing toxins, and you need to take care of, give other antibiotics that are going to take care of toxins. So let's just talk about antibiotics. We know meropenem broad spectrum covers most of your gram-positive, gram-negative, except your MRSA. It doesn't cover your MRSA. It also covers your anaerobes. Okay, so it's the broadest spectrum antibiotic that you could use, carbapenems. Among your monobactams, aztreonam, basically gram-negative bacteria it's going to cover. It has no gram-positive or anaerobic cover. Its spectrum is similar to aminoglycosides, but without the renal toxicity. Then you have aminoglycosides, basically for pseudomonas, as an add-on drug. You use it for mycobacteria, you use it for atypical infections, and you may sometimes use it in infective endocarditis with beta-lactams for enterococcus or staphylococcus as an add-on drug. Fluoroquinolones, again for atypical infections. Ciprofloxacin, good gram-negative cover, good for UTI and infectious diarrhea, and could use it in combination for pseudomonas. Levofloxacin, better gram-positive coverage than ciprofloxacin. It's basically reserved for LRTIs. Clindamycin, it covers your staph, especially your toxin-producing staph. It covers your streptococcus and the anaerobes. It has no gram-negative cover or enterococcal. It's a drug which most of the people don't use it much, and I tend to use a lot of this drug, clindamycin. Tigecycline, it's a tetracycline, active against both gram-positive and gram-negative. It doesn't have anti-pseudomonas effect. It works against your Acinetobacter. So most of the time you land up using this in a especially for ESBLs, acinetobacter, you start using tigecycline. Glycopeptides. Now, glycopeptides, gram-positives, MRSA, corn, streptococcus, enterococcus. You don't use it for vancomycin-resistant enterococcus because it's not going to work. Whenever you have a staph aureus, always use cloxacillin first, your beta-lactams first, because they are more bactericidal as compared to vancomycin. So don't start any staph, don't just start vancomycin. Cloxacillin is better. Poor CSF penetration. So remember, whenever you're using these, CSF penetration is going to be poor. Then daptomycin. Daptomycin was specifically for Staphylococcus aureus. It's only recommended for skin and soft tissue infections and right-sided endocarditis. Don't use it for treating staph aureus in the lung because it's inactivated by the surfactant. Linezolid, most important, it's a static drug, not a sidal. It's not to be used as first line for community-acquired pneumonias. Most of the patients are being given that. It's 100% oral bioavailable, so IV is equivalent to oral. It's active against MRSA, VRE, so use it for those. Don't use it for community acquired because you don't have anything for VRSA or VRE. You need linezolid over there. It has no action against the gram negatives. The streptogramins, bactericidal, only for staph, again, skin and soft tissue infections. MRSA, MSSA, corn, streptococcus, VRE. We hardly use this in children. Colistin. The oldest drug that has come back in reuse, it's on the cell membrane, so it's a different mechanism of action. Salvage therapy, Pseudomonas, Acinetobacter, nephrotoxic and neurotoxic. Now when I'm using colistin, I have to look at the combination. Is this child on amphoby? Is this child on an aminoglycoside? Is this child on vancomycin? I don't want to combine nephrotoxic drugs together. And you need to adjust the dose in renal failure. So when we talk about rational use of antibiotics in PICU, first thing is you need to establish whether it's a bacterial infection. Is there fever? Is there CRP? Procalcitonin. We use that quite often now, procalcitonin, to determine. Second thing is we have to determine whether it's a community or hospital-acquired infection. Where is the site of infection? Depending on that, we can estimate which is the organism, what are the likely pathogens, and what's the, if you have a lab which has isolated an organism, then what's the resistance pattern? Prior to starting antibiotics, always send cultures from the relevant site. Try and avoid broad-spectrum antibiotics, especially your meropenem, imipenem, cefepime, and vancomycin, okay? Because otherwise you're going to be left with a lot of drugs that you can't use. If we talk about common infections in the PICU, we know that it's VAP, which is the commonest, bloodstream infections, BSIs. MRSA is very uncommon in the pediatric ICU. It's more common in the adult ICU. When we talk about VAP, it's usually uncommon in the first 5 to 7 days of ventilation. It's usually defined as pneumonia that develops after minimum 48 hours after the child is put on ventilator. You need to know what is causing VAP, so you need to know the prevalent organism in your ICU. You have a VAP bundle which every ICU has to take care of whenever you put a child on ventilator, and you need to follow this bundle where you need to have a head elevation, you need to have a daily assessment of readiness to extubate. Take care of ulcers, oral care protocol, and deep vein thrombosis in older children. The bloodstream infections, again, if the catheter is new, unlikely. There's no role actually to change catheter every time you suspect an infection. So don't just change because you've suspected it. You should take peripheral and central line cultures. If cultures are positive, then probably you would need to change the catheter. But again, it depends on what you're growing. If you're growing staph, if you're growing something that is a biofilm, you need to change. But if you're growing something that could be managed without removing a catheter, then you could still try doing that. Most important for prevention is antibiotic lock. I don't think a lot of ICUs are following antibiotic lock. If you have a central line in, get the antibiotic lock into picture, so then you won't actually get a lot of infections, bloodstream infections. MRSA risk factor is cephalosporin use or quinolone use. Long-term catheters and residents in long-term facility care. ESBL risk factor, again, long hospital stay, presence of catheters, any catheters. Abdominal surgery, gut colonization, gastrostomy tube, prior antibiotics, mechanical ventilation. Now, I just wanted to go through cases because I know this was a very theoretical talk. I wanted to discuss a few cases. These are actual cases that I've seen. 2.5-month-old child has has been in the PICU for the last 15 days. His admission was for a pneumonia. He's been on ventilator, initially treated with meropenem and vancomycin for 1 week. No response, changed to colistin, clarithromycin and ciprofloxacin. After 4 days, the child has been weaned off the ventilator. Now this child has developed diarrhea for the past 1 week, along with thrombocytopenia. So they thought it was a fungal infection because the child has received so many antibiotics. Fluconazole was started. And now, since the last 1 day, the diarrhea has become bloody. So I was called in to assess this child. Now, by the time I'm called in, this child has received meropenem, vanco, colistin, clarithro, cipro, flucon. Okay. What do you think is the cause of the diarrhea in this child? Let's go into the history further. He was born premature, 2.5 month old. Premature at 29 weeks, birth weight 1.1. NICU for 1 month. In the NICU, antibiotic was piperacillin, tazobactam, cefotaxime. He's been home for 1 month actually. And weighted discharge was 1 kg. So this is the NICU antibiotic. You know the antibiotics that were given in the PIC. When I see this child, counts are normal. He has thrombocytopenia. He has a negative CRP. Cultures are negative. Stool occult blood positive. Coagulation profile normal. Because there was this neonatal issue of prematurity and NICU stay and all that, whether this was congenital CMV, CMV was negative. So what are we dealing with in this child? Yeah, and how do we think it's, how do we prove it's Clostridium? We got a stool examination which didn't show any parasites or pus cells. Yeah, so Clostridium produces the toxin, so we actually can test for toxins in the stool. So exotoxin A and exotoxin B. The thing is, a lot of neonates harbor Clostridium in their stool in the first 2 years of, I mean, children up to first 2 years of life harbor Clostridium in their stool. You could grow a toxin also on a, when you ask for a stool examination, so you won't be able to interpret in children less than 2 years. But you need to take the clinical picture into place. Now, which antibiotic should we use in this child? If we go back to the antibiotics that the child was taking, the child had already taken meropenem and vancomycin for 1 week earlier. So what antibiotic shall we give?
Metro.
Metro, IV or oral? Why not IV? Okay. Now here in Clostridium, oral vancomycin is preferred. Okay? And metronidazole is actually preferred as IV because its colonic concentrations are superior. And clinical failure has been reported with parenteral vancomycin. So if you're going to use orally, use vancomycin. If you're going to use IV, use metronidazole. Let's take this case. Now this case is currently admitted. I won't tell you the hospital. 2-year-old boy, he got admitted with a swelling under the mandible. He had fever. He had difficulty in breathing and swallowing. A CT was done which was suggestive of Leydig's angina. He undergoes surgery. The initial gram stain shows gram-positive cocaine clusters. Post-op, this child is on ventilator. He started on amoxicillin, clavulanic acid, amikacin and metronidazole. No response for 1 week. He shifted to piperacillin, tazobactam, amoxiclavin, metro. The CRP by then increases from 46 to 192. Culture from wherever they tried an FNA, this drainage, has not grown anything. Ludwig's angina. So is the choice of antibiotics correct? And what should we give? Why is the choice wrong? You have a Ludwig's angina. Ludwig's angina, likely pathogens are gram-positive cocci. So streptococcus, it's going to be staphylococcus, it's going to be anaerobes. It's something from the local oral flora, right? So if we need to cover these organisms, what would have been our initial antibiotic of choice? We need to cover anaerobes, we need to cover streptococcus, we need to cover staphylococcus. If you take Ludwig's angina, staphylococcus itself is very rare cause. So the commonest cause is actually streptococcus and anaerobes. So our drug of choice actually would have been just penicillin and metronidazole in this patient.
Crystalline?
Yeah, crystalline penicillin. IV penicillin and metronidazole. This child has started on amoxiclav. I don't know why they add clavulanic acid. Any advantage of clavulanic acid?
No.
No. Clavulanic acid is basically for your ESBLs that you're going to use. It has an effect on anaerobes. So if you're using amoxiclav, you could have an effect on anaerobes. But you're anyway giving metronidazole. Role of amic acid?
No.
We use amic acid for gram-negative organisms or gentamicin as an add-on for gram-positive.
So actually no role. 1 week later, amikacin gets omitted, piperacillin and tazobactam added, amoxicillin metro. We know that he has gram-positive cocaine clusters, which is a likely organism staph. So we have it in cultures. Now, any role of this combination? Piperacillin, tazobactam, amoxicillin, metro. Okay, now I'll tell you one. Piperacillin, penicillin group. Amoxicillin, penicillin group. So you have two from same group. Piperacillin, gram-negative. We are not thinking of gram-negative here at all. Tazobactam, clavulanic acid. Why are we adding two ESBL covers? Actually, no role. So you're using two antibiotics from the same group, which has got no meaning. Metronidazole. So when I saw this patient, they were reluctant, the ICU was reluctant to stop the piperacillin tazobactam. My choice of antibiotic here would have just been cloxacillin and clindamycin in this chair. Yeah. So it was not possible to change that. So what we would have, what I had to do is, because they were not reluctant to change piperacillin tazobactam, I didn't want to add clox to piperacillin tazobactam. Again, two antibiotics of the same group. So what I decided was I'm going to continue with piperacillin tazobactam, add linezolid, and change metro to clinda. Now why did I do that? Because if I'm suspecting staph, which is causing a skin and soft tissue infection, most likely it's going to be PBL. I cannot prove a PBL until I do a molecular test, which is not available in most of the labs. So if I need to cover PBL, toxin-producing staph, I need to have Clinda. Clinda would have worked, or any other drug like cotrimoxazole or any other drug. Why I preferred Clinda? Because Clinda would also cover the anaerobes. So this combination, so what we decided is, okay, the IC wants to continue piperacillin tazobactam, we'll continue that. We'll add Clinda and linezolid, and we'll stop amoxicillin metro. 48 hours later, the CRP has fallen from 192 to 40, back to 40. Okay, the child's fever has started touching baseline. We still don't have a culture in this child. But this is based on what we are seeing in this patient that we've decided this is going to be the antibiotic choice. So a lot of times you have to juggle with your antibiotics left, right, center to actually get what you want. You may end up giving so many antibiotics which are not required. You try to come down narrow spectrum, but you're unable to do that. Now this child, 2-year-old female child, fever for 7 days, swelling over bilateral lower limbs for 7 days, and breathlessness. When you see her, she's hypertensive, she's febrile, she's tachypneic, tachycardia, there's cellulitis with an query and evolving abscess in both lower limbs, chest has bilateral crepes, she immediately requires ventilation. These are our investigations. If you can see, initially she had leukopenia, then her count started increasing. Her CRP initially was 384 and gradually the CRP has started coming down. So if she was in a bad infection, leukopenia, high CRP, kind of an abscess in both lower limbs, and a pneumonia. So cultures grew MSSA. Which antibiotic should we use? It's an MSSA. Cloxacillin. Single clox.
Along with clindamycin.
Yeah, again we may be thinking of PBL staph, we could add clindamycin. Or probably we could use clox and genta as an add-on drug. So you got a choice of antibiotics here. So no need to just go on to vancomycin or go on to cefotaxime or other amoxicillin, clavulanic acid. Just use the antibiotic you think it's going to work. So I think I'm going to stop here. Rational antibiotics has to be individualized patient to patient. There cannot be a standard guideline which says that this is the antibiotic of choice in this particular infection. You need to rationalize your antibiotics. Thank you very much.